Let me first do the introductions very briefly. We don't have a hell of a lot of time. We have two unusual characters who have offered to help us clarify a world that certainly needs clarification. Ben Shapiro, surrogate more or less for Mitt Romney, and Brian Whitman, surrogate more or less for President Obama. We've never done this before at CSIRC. In many cases, the rules are the rules until they're no longer the rules. But what I've done, talking to a number of people, is to put together a few questions that are a little bit different structurally than what we just listened to. And there are actually a number of points, and we'd like to give a couple minutes for each of the participants to answer. Some of the material is redundant, but it's phrased in a little, in a somewhat different way. I think the point really was to try to obligate the candidates or the surrogates for the candidates to speak specifically about issues that are of concern to an audience of students and faculty, and really an international audience, and not just an American audience, not just a local audience, who are looking at America and trying to understand what it is, why it is, what it is, what it should mm-hmm. be, and learning lessons in a number of ways that might obligate other places at other times based on what they're learning here. So this is, you shouldn't, let me read this off, I'll read it to you. And then you guys take a crack at it for a couple of minutes. And what you can do, Stephanie, is just let's give Ben and Brian a couple of minutes to take a crack at it, and then we'll go on to the next one. So let me read this to you, and we'll go from here. As we listen to the political debate in America today, each side insists, quote, my party is 100% correct. The opposition party is not a partner in governing, but rather an obstacle to governance and to the truth. Caricature. Obama assigned the bipartisan Simpson-Bowles Committee the task of developing a series of innovative strategies for confronting America's budget and national debt problems. Among its proposals, the committee suggested $1 new taxation for every three and reduced spending. The Republicans have said they wouldn't increase taxes, even if that ratio were 10 and reduce spending to 1 and increase in taxes. The question goes to the heart of decision-making in an American democracy. Does either side consider the possibility that their policy positions might be incorrect and or that the other side has constructive content to offer, or that the general welfare should supersede the advocacy of a single party? How do the two parties understand the mechanism for exchanging ideas and governing in America today? Are models like Reagan, Tip O'Neill, Clinton, Gingrich irrelevant? Considering that whoever wins the election, the House and Senate will likely be closely divided again, what is the working model for bipartisan decision-making in contemporary America? Does either candidate speak for a supra-party vision of decision-making? So you want to take a crack?
I mean, that's really
point?
About seven questions. But let me start off by saying this. I'm not a surrogate for Mitt Romney. The way that Mitt Romney would answer that question is by saying that, of course, he stands for bipartisanship and wants to get things done. And President Obama, I'm sure, would answer that the same way. That he wants to be bipartisan and get things done. And I know Brian is not a surrogate for President Obama directly either. I think we're more spokespeople for general conservatism and general liberalism. I think that's a fairer expression of who we are. And for those who don't know, we co-host together on 870 in the mornings, 6 to 9 a.m. I think that we've strayed from the founding vision of what government is designed to do. The idea that accomplishing things is the central goal of government is not entirely correct. The central goal of government is to protect certain inviolate rights that are enshrined in the Constitution. And when government exceeds those boundaries, when government gets into the business of doing things for the sake of doing things, it very quickly oversteps the boundaries of rationality. And that's why you see both Republicans and Democrats, they do have bipartisan agreement on one thing, which is spending lots and lots and lots of your money and raising your taxes and putting you in debt for the rest of your natural lives and putting your children and your grandchildren in debt for the rest of your natural lives. That doesn't come from doing nothing. That comes from doing something. In fact, it comes from doing many things. One of the ways that the founders designed the system is that they designed it so that there would be tremendous gridlock. That was the purpose of the system. Because here's the deal. We all vote for what we want out of government. I want cash. I want a car. I want government to pay for my loans, my student loans. I want government to pay for my health care, all of that. But the bottom line is this. Unless those factions counteract one another, all we end up with is government that is trying to pay for everyone from somebody else's pocket. And that's why government originally was designed largely to have interest counteract interest, and that would provide for freedom. Individual freedom only exists in the absence of an overarching government forcing you to do something.
Okay. I would say that my friend Ben is in the minority when he expresses an affection for gridlock in government. I don't think most people in America desire a gridlock government. When this president, Obama, was elected 4 years ago, it was just a couple of years after that the Republican Senator Mitch McConnell said that his number one priority as Senate Majority Leader, would be to make sure the president wasn't reelected. That's what he said.
Obamacare, correct.
Okay, after Obamacare, before Obamacare. That's an unbelievable statement. To be a Senate leader and say that your number one priority isn't the environment, education, jobs, pick something. No, it's making sure he loses his job. Well, that's embarrassing. I guess he gets a little bit of credit. There's some nobility and honesty, I guess. But that's an amazing thing
to say. To finish the phrase, what he actually said is, my first priority is to get rid of the president or to change his policies. And that's true for all politicians. You want to see people who don't agree with you not in power.
But, you know, this is a very peculiar way to define the conceptual model that American government represents. It wasn't designed for gridlock. I mean, that's a very peculiar way to define
it. No, it is. Read the Federalist
Papers. Hang on a second. You read it.
I've read it multiple times, sir.
Well, reread it. What it was designed to do.
Where did you go to law school?
I went to Harvard, unfortunately. I've been apologizing ever since.
Undergrad or law school?
Let's not get into credentials.
Let's
just deal with the content. Well, you got a lot to overcome. I think here's the point, and it's a conceptual point. It's not a unique American vision at all. It belongs to a discourse that took place in Europe, in France, in England, and it had to do with a number of discussions, but in principle, it has to do with balancing constituencies so that certain constituencies don't overrun other constituencies. Now, that may be another way of saying what he said, but the objective is not gridlock, and given the fact that there are adversaries and various constituencies, and you don't need to go to Harvard Law School to learn that, if there are different constituencies, the operational principle of governing has something to do with an exchange. And when there are people whose intent seems to be to prohibit exchange, then the operational capacity of the government diminishes. So if that's the objective of government, then we got a great success. If the objective of the government, and I think the point on the right, which is the point on the left, was correct, that most people in America are interested in solving conceptual issues, not in pontificating as if we are another set of ayatollahs. And there are ayatollahs in all places of the world, not only in Tehran. So from my point of view, this kind of sanctimoniousness, meaning it has to be this way, or the discussion that the founding fathers, who said so? The founding fathers. The founding fathers set up a government where you had to have property to vote. The founding fathers set up a government where you had to be a man to vote. The founding fathers, and for years on, the Supreme Court of the United States said separate but equal is okay. This is a government that conceptually makes possible the evolution of ideas. So when everybody says the founding fathers and everyone else should genuflect, So this is not Harvard Law School's idea or anything. It means that we're unwilling to continue to see that there are any number of issues that need to be adjudicated. Okay, I'm done with that.
Well, hold on a second, because that was a nice filibuster. Okay, what you do...
Response to your filibuster.
Well, my filibuster was about 2 minutes and yours was six, and I'm the guest and you're the moderator.
Well, I had three times as many good things to say. Go ahead.
Here is the deal. When it comes to government, the question is, how do you do the greatest good for the greatest number? Okay, and one of the ways that you do the greatest good for the greatest number in the founding conception, and yes, in the conception of many conservatives, is to get government out of the business of telling people what to do as a general matter. One of the ways that you ensure that is by preventing people from using government as a vehicle for their own particular interests. That is why I'm speaking about gridlock. The idea that people can use government, you can create a coalition of people who are willing to scratch each other's back, pay each other a lot of money, and get things done. The things that get done are the things that matter. It's not just, does government get things done or does government not get things done? It's, does government do good things or does government do bad things? And the idea that bipartisanship as a whole is a good thing is not true. It depends what bipartisanship is in pursuit of. And so for you to sit there and say that bipartisanship...
But that works both ways. Gridlock also is an ipso facto a virtue.
But gridlock
nor
in the system... But gridlock
so
in the system...
So then let's talk about the content of ideas and we'll decide when bipartisanship...
You asked me about systems of government, not about content of ideas. If you want to talk about ideas, we can do that as well.
Let's go then. Oh, well,
I think that we see, most of the time, I think we see gridlock broken through in American government when politicians are faced with when self-preservation kicks in.
Let's go on to number two. Over the last 100 years or so, American foreign policy has confronted combative nation states in the First World War, competing ideologies in the Second World War, the Cold War between communists and capitalists, and most recently something referred to as Islam versus the West. Do you think the current model of the American role in the world affairs is up to date, or are we continuing to reuse strategic models from the middle and late 20th century? How is the contemporary world of Islam versus the West different from the Cold War model in terms of the implementation of strategic American objectives? Fundamentally, is America's vision of its international role amenable to change by Obama or by Romney? You want to take a crack?
I mean, again, a lot to unpack there. I think that the question of what each candidate thinks America's international role is, I do think that they have different visions of what America's international role is. I think that President Obama seeks a slightly humbler America on the world stage. He wants an America with less influence. I think that he wants an America that, quote unquote, respects the values of others. I think that Mitt Romney, like most Republicans, is more hawkish on this. I think that he wants it to promote values of American exceptionalism. I think in all cases, the question is, how do you get there? The problem that you've seen, I think, and it spanned administrations. It's not unique to President Obama. But it was true for President Bush as well, is the idea that simply voting is a cure-all. It clearly is not. I mean, you've had regions of the world that vote for dictatorship and vote for tyranny. I mean, you've seen it in the Gaza Strip, for example, with Hamas. You've seen it now with regard to the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt. And the question is going to be, if America really believes in its own values, are those values worth promulgating on the world stage? And it's a decision that Americans have to make. And I think that I do think it's amenable to change by a particular candidate, but I think in the end it's going to be up to the American people. Do we feel that it is our role to be that force for our vision of liberalism, or do we feel the kind of United Nations, all values are equal multiculturalism that's been promulgated by some on the left? I obviously stand for a more muscular version of American foreign policy, but I think clearly the American people can make that choice. There are costs and benefits to each.
One of the questions here, reading it again, is do you think that the current model of the American role in world affairs is up to date? I don't think that it's up to date, and I think it's too expensive. I think it costs too much money. I think that what we've tried to do in the world, beginning with President Bush after 9/11, we simply can't afford. We can't pay to do all of this in every corner of the world where there's somebody running a country who we don't like.
Well, to be fair, that wasn't just Bush, right? I mean, Clinton got involved in Somalia. He got involved in Sudan.
Okay, but the protracted, fair point, Ben, but the protracted wars in Afghanistan and Iraq, these are George Bush's efforts. He's no longer president, and I don't blame him for the circumstances we're in today, but it came up in this debate tonight, and it's worth mentioning. All of this talk about the deficit that President Obama has had, now it's up to $16 trillion. I saw the Republicans had that nice, flashy deficit clock at their convention that kept ticking and ticking and ticking as if it was kind of foreign to them. Well, how'd that get there? Mitt Romney called deficits immoral tonight. He should call George Bush and remind him that just how immoral they are. President Obama came into office, two wars underway, Iraq, Afghanistan. They didn't stop. Much to President Obama's credit, the funding of those wars didn't stop. The protection of the men and women serving overseas was not sacrificed, and that costs money.
Well,
we can't afford it.
Let me go back to one thing, because you used the term promulgated without defining what it means. And the question is, when America dispenses foreign policy in the world, how does it do that? And a corollary to that, I mean, it's interesting, you know, so the Republicans jump on in an election. You're right about Hamas, this is true, they were elected. You're right about the Muslim Brotherhood, whatever exactly that constitutes. Seems to me that you don't have much patience with the process of an evolving democracy, hypothetically. If you look at the evolution of American democracy over time and how it's added and subtracted and included and enlarged and so on, why aren't you patient with Egyptian democracy? Well, or does it have to be on day one what you see in America on day 225?
I think that if there were a long-term hope for the liberalization of a particular democracy, obviously you stick with it. But there are really only two ways that you develop a liberal democracy, historically speaking. One is to invade a nation and spend enormous amounts of some treasure and blood in order to occupy it, the way that we did with Japan, or do horrible things in the process. Or you have to wait it out until people develop the idea of liberalism on their own. The fact is that liberalism predates democracy. Democracy does not predate liberalism. If you give people the vote, they're not necessarily going to become liberals. If you have a bunch of liberals, eventually they will develop the concept of a democracy. So, you know, when you look at the Muslim Brotherhood, the idea that giving them a vote is somehow going to push Egypt closer toward liberalism.
I'm not saying that so much, but then what you're talking about is if Mubarak works, you support Mubarak. If the Shah of Iran works, you support the Shah of Iran. So you have to take, there are consequences for
Yes, there are. There are consequences for each of these. And the question is going to be the alternatives, and neither alternative is good.
Okay,
but,
good.
You know, in the case of Mubarak, in my opinion, the alternative was better to leave Mubarak in power than to leave the Muslim Brotherhood in power in Egypt.
Well, but then you have to see where it goes. The question is if you're sufficiently patient.
Of course, yeah. Let's put it this way. There were centuries of dictatorship in the West before there was democracy in the West.
Well, that's right, and the memory of that ought to give you a little bit of patience. On the other hand, you have to deal with things in an immediate
way. It's a gradual process.
Yeah, okay. Let me get to this one. Number three, Republicans are fond of using the expression American, American exceptionalism. Do you think the current inability of American government to make timely decisions on, and we've covered this a bit, on substantial governance issues shows the world that the American system is truly an exception and a model to be imitated?
Mike.
Brian? Yeah.
Well, I think that there has been some debate. Ben and I have had this debate on our radio show in the morning about whether or not President Obama believes in American exceptionalism, and you touched on it a moment ago. I've said to Ben on the radio, and I'll say here to you guys, it would seem to me that clearly he does.
Brian, excuse me, maybe you could tell us what the American exceptionalism actually is?
The context in which we discussed American exceptionalism vis-a-vis President Obama Ben has made the case, I'm not putting words in Ben's mouth, but he's made the case on the radio that President Obama thinks America is exceptional, like Brits thinks Britain's exceptional.
Which is what he said, yes.
Like
Greeks,
Greece thinks Greece is exceptional.
Yeah.
I will say this about the words American exceptionalism vis-a-vis this president, and I've said it to Ben, and this is one that really, where he and I in the morning on the radio kind of got into it. It would seem to me that any person, African-American person, a black man, born in an American citizen, contrary to what Donald Trump might want you to believe, an American citizen born during the Civil Rights Movement, when black people aren't allowed to vote, to grow up to be the first black president of the greatest nation in human history, if he doesn't understand that America's exceptional, then whoever would?
But the definition is, because I think the definition carries a connotation, and I think particularly with Republicans, that that there's something intrinsically and enduringly remarkable.
Yes, about America.
The American ideal,
correct.
The American persona, and in confrontation or in conflict with another,
yes.
The obligation of America is to push that.
Well, you know what? Two things. Number one, I do think America is exceptional. Sometimes liberals are afraid to say things like this. I'm a liberal, but I think we've got the greatest nation in human history. And I think most liberals believe that. Oftentimes, liberals are portrayed as people who are unpatriotic. In fact, it's just the opposite. Now, as for American exceptionalism, and you say kind of pushing it on other countries, a colleague of mine compared it to an ice cream sundae. He was talking about Afghanistan. And he said, you know, we brought a beautiful ice cream sundae. I mean, you know, a couple of scoops of vanilla ice cream, a couple of scoops of chocolate, some strawberry, a lot of whipped cream, some nuts, and some caramel on top, and a cherry or maybe two or three. And we put it in front of him. We said, it's the greatest thing in the world. Don't you want it? They said, nah, we don't really have to have it. If another nation doesn't want to be America, I don't think America should try to make that nation America. And I really don't.
And we fundamentally disagree on this. I mean, I think the long-term vision of the United States is to make many more countries like the United States. That's not the immediate vision of the United States. Doesn't mean it's always practical. But the fact is this. The United States is the freest and best nation in the history of humanity. And
Is it empirically so?
No, it depends on what we do.
Is it empirically so? Is it so because you say so? Is it so because if you don't put a flag on your lapel, that means you don't believe? In other words, what makes it so?
What makes it so is that we enjoy freedoms in the United States that make us a magnet country for the rest of the globe.
But you've just told us that it's, that in practical terms, it's difficult to implement that, ergo Hamas, Morsi,
yes.
And so on and so
yes.
on.
Yes, I mean, there are conflicting value systems. And I believe American exceptionalism means that we believe our value system is superior to other value systems. I mean, that's necessary in the definition of the word. Either you believe that or you don't.
May I add very briefly that this desire to make other nations appreciate our way of government, again, for me, I think it's the greatest nation in the world. Other countries, you know, they don't want it. But what has happened is that in pursuit of converting these nations, Afghanistan, Iraq, you know, Iran, I mean, whatever the next one's going to be, in the effort to convert them to liberal democracies, we've stopped being America. We have 23 million people who can't get a job. We have students who can't.
It's not universal employment that makes America.
Well, America doesn't. Yeah, let me go on in there.
No, I think it's important.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to follow up on that. But in pragmatic terms, I mean, if you're for American exceptionalism, then let's go to the following. This is the one Americans supported, Saddam Hussein, Stephanie. So it's down the line a little bit. Here, Ben.
Yeah, we'll find it. Don't worry.
America supported Saddam Hussein against Iran, then later attacked Iraq. America supported the Shah of Iran, whose fall brought the Ayatollah Khomeini to power. America supported the Mujahideen against Russia and Afghanistan, and is now at war against the same Mujahideen in Afghanistan. The Republicans tell us that Obama is an apologizer for previous conduct of American foreign policy. Do you think a frank discussion of the history of America's prior relationships with the nations in the Middle East, including acknowledgement of possible errors, is helpful to our understanding of American decision-making going forward, or should the acknowledgement of possible errors in judgment be considered a weakness? Should America be presented as a nation that can do no wrong?
Well, no, and I don't think anybody presents America as a nation that can do no wrong. I mean, we're responsible for one of the greatest wrongs in human history in the presence of American slavery. The idea that, you know, anybody would present America as completely blameless in human history is ridiculous. But I do think.
But the comment that Romney and
I think apologizing on the world stage for previous American conduct is a different question. And the reason I say that is because it has certain effects. When you do certain things, they have certain effects. When you apologize on the world stage in front of groups like the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt, and you specifically invite them to the Cairo speech, and then you embolden them to hijack what could have been a much better Arab Spring into something that turned very negative.
Yeah, but
in
this
Egypt.
Is a whole series of suppositions. In the first place, whether it's Obama's role to invite people to a particular
event. Well, I agree, but.
And the Muslim Brotherhood, which has been hanging around almost 100 years now,
correct.
Is likely to have a substantial role in that country at this moment, whether Obama likes them or hates them.
Well, I mean, that's your assumption. Well,
okay, Saddam Hussein was supported. Rumsfeld was in there with Saddam. And years later, he was after
sure.
him. Okay, and
the
Shah of Iran was America's guy, and Khomeini came in to some extent. If you're a student of history and you chase these things in retrospect, to some extent, the Ayatollah and what's going on in Iran belongs to a discourse and policy decisions that America had a substantial role in.
I agree.
Okay.
I mean, America has done things wrong.
Yeah, right or wrong. It did what it did based on what it thought were its interests at the time.
And there are arguments about it at the time, yes.
And easier to look back and so on and so on. Therefore, discussing those questions with a view to understanding how what happened, and therefore understanding our role in the making of the whole event, is not what I would consider to be an apology.
That's the role
it's
in American
kind of exegesis.
Well,
it's a discussion of how what happened.
And I disagree to the extent that discussions had in different contexts mean different things. If you're having a discussion in your basement about whether to cede Czechoslovakia to Hitler, that's very different than if you're doing it, you know, in Munich. This is the question is whether you're having those discussions on the world stage in front of a group of people.
Wait. I mean, this is a huge jump to give the Sudetenland to somebody. What we're talking about is talking about what
you asked
Neville Chamberlain
you asked the question,
did.
Is apologizing on the world stage a problem?
Right.
My answer is yes.
But
I'm not equating that with having a discussion.
I understand that, but going forward is different than going backward. If you're sitting in your basement talking about whether Neville Chamberlain should give up the Sudetenland, it's one thing. If he gave it up already, and 20 years later you're now talking about the history.
Okay, let me draw a different analogy. If you're sitting in your basement talking about whether the Versailles Treaty, if you're sitting in your basement deciding whether the Versailles Treaty was properly carried out, which had ramifications for the negotiations with Hitler in 1938, that is different than if you're having that discussion with Hitler in Munich. The bottom line is this. When you're discussing the ramifications or the history of foreign policy, it obviously has a consequence, otherwise you wouldn't be discussing it. The question is the setting in which you discuss it and the people to whom you are saying things.
Well, let me tell you something. You said something as a constituent element of American exceptionalism, and you said openness. Openness doesn't mean in the basement.
I said in the United States press. He's the
Cairo.
President of the United States. He went overseas and he apologized for American conduct overseas.
I don't think he apologized.
He did it repeatedly. He did it in Turkey. He did it in Cairo. He did it in Europe twice.
I don't think he apologized at all.
Well, that's your definition of apology.
My definition of an explanation is not the equivalent of an apology. Explanations lead to understanding. PR.
So let me ask you this. Do you feel there's now better understanding of our position in the Middle East?
Oh, let me ask
Have
you
things
this.
Improved?
Do you feel if we had excluded the Muslim Brotherhood and Obama hadn't gone there, that Morsi wouldn't have been elected?
Morsi would never have had the chance to be elected. Mubarak would likely still be in power.
Well, he would probably be dead, in which case the army would run the country, which is what it was doing anyway.
And you know what? We would actually have a military ally in Egypt as opposed to a country that's about to violate all of its peace treaties with its neighbors.
But it's a very unstable government, and when Mubarak goes, and this happens to all tyrannies, you don't know who's coming next anyway.
And this is significantly more stable, clearly.
I think this question asks a simpler question, maybe a larger question in some ways. Does diplomacy, does discourse, does conversation with countries that you don't exactly see eye to eye with mean weakness? I say wholeheartedly no. It absolutely doesn't mean weakness to go and speak with countries that you have disagreements with.
Depends on what you're saying, depends on which country you're talking about.
Well, for example, we've talked about Egypt. I know there were some, and I think Ben might be among them, who thought, you know, right away after the election, you know, this is it. This is it. Look at the step they have taken. President Obama, because he's the president and he's not a talk show host like us, probably has to handle it a little more diplomatically and say, well, hold on a second. You know, we're gonna see what plays out here. That's what being president. I think that consideration, that contemplation, is something we desire in an American president. I think Americans desire in their president someone who seeks to make the world a safer place through dialogue with countries that have different forms of governance, that do things that we don't like, that...
I'm all for it when it works. I'm not when it doesn't.
Well, I mean, no, but you don't know if it works if you don't talk.
Don't forget, I mean, we raised the point initially about whether the behavior of America in governing currently is an example to the world of American exceptionalism and something to be imitated. So the fact that there is amorphously in many places, including Tiananmen Square, places like that, a constituency for democracy and the expression of individual liberty, we might do things that are conducive to that based on how we spread our culture or our ideas, as opposed to saying we need 250,000 boots on the ground because Iraq has weapons of mass destruction.
And what I'm saying is that America has been, in the last 10 years, in an almost unprecedented globe-trotting mission to change countries that don't really want to be changed.
Well, that was the entire Cold War. It was a 50-year war.
Well,
right? I mean,
we were in
a couple of different places.
Okay,
there.
Yeah, that's true. But in the last 10 years after 9/11, to go to Afghanistan, to go to Iraq, where clearly these hearts don't want to be changed. They don't need to be our friends, but we need to deal with them. There's a difference.
Well,
we have people in our lives who aren't our friends.
And I think Ben used, maybe the term was robust, a slightly more robust sense of American role as a foreign policy agent. And when you listen to Mitt Romney talk about Syria, and when you listen to Mitt Romney talk about Iran, what he owes us and what he should say is, should we fight a war with Assad? Should we fight a war in Syria? Should we fight a war in Iran? What is he advocating? Because in a way, it's easy enough to be macho Camacho, but in a vague way, does he want to go fight a war in Iran?
Well, I think there are alternatives beyond war and simply chatting. I mean, there is covert action, right? I mean, in 1948, with regard to the Italian communists, there was an election in Italy, and the Italian communists were poised to be elected, and the United States used the force of the CIA to essentially throw that election away from the communists. And to my view, that's a great thing, because now Italy is not a communist country.
Maybe, but then if you want to use that kind of logic, then how do you account for what happened in Iran with the Shah? The CIA also supported the Shah. It didn't work.
Well, no, the CIA abandoned the Shah. I mean, the fact is that Jimmy Carter abandoned the Shah, which is why the Shah fell.
Let's do the public relations one. It fits right in. You have that, Stephanie? You guys see that? I read it. Public relations is a substantial business in America. Brands, images, slogans are essential advertising tools. PR campaigns often utilize focus groups, polling samples, debating coaches, and so on. Is it fair to conclude that politicians are sold to the American public the way hamburgers are sold to the American public? Are politicians and burgers interchangeable? Do you feel that the current state of American advertising for political campaigns is an effective way of examining alternative policy positions in American governance?
They're not interchangeable because I like burgers.
Don't like politicians.
Correct. As far as whether politicians are marketed like products, of course they're marketed like products. The issue, though, is that politicians have always been marketed like products. If you go back to the history of presidential campaigns, even before 1960, before the rise of television, television accentuated this. But if you go all the way back to the very early elections, there was talk about whether, you know, a candidate who was particularly striking physically had a better chance of being elected. This is true of Jefferson versus Adams, going all the way back to 1800, when Jefferson's minions were calling Adams a wig-throwing old woman, and Adams's minions were calling Jefferson a philanderer. So the idea that candidate, in a democracy, unfortunately, this is sort of the way that people work in general. People don't tend to make fully considered decisions about policy as a general matter. You tend to make, science shows that you tend to make, and this is, you know, in our architecture school, I'm preaching to the choir, but you tend to make decisions about people the same way that you make decisions about whether you like something or not, and it all happens within the first split second that you see somebody. So the people who liked Mitt Romney right away are still gonna like Mitt Romney. The people who liked Obama right away are still generally going to like President Obama. This is why likability matters, because the fact is that Mitt Romney is not running on positions that are substantially different from those of Ronald Reagan. It's just that Ronald Reagan was a substantially better candidate than Mitt Romney was.
Well, this is what I was going to say. I think this question is kind of appropriate for tonight after seeing these two candidates, because the Republican Party would love to have a candidate as well defined as a Happy Meal. They don't have it. You don't really know what Mitt Romney is, who he is, what he believes. It changes all the time. In 1994, he was a liberal. Tonight, he tried to describe his tax policies as liberal. He was pro-choice in 1994 when he ran against Ted Kennedy in Massachusetts. He talks about being a businessman. Sometimes, very rarely, does he talk about his 4 years as governor of Massachusetts, which was a disaster, where he ran in a challenge economy saying, I'll fix the economy, and he didn't. And young people by the thousands were moving out of Massachusetts because there were no jobs. Mitt Romney, the reason Mitt Romney can't be marketed as successfully as a hamburger from McDonald's is because you know what a hamburger from McDonald's is. You know what it looks like, you know what it tastes like. You know how it makes you feel after you eat it. With this character, he's got to feel, I mean, as I say on the radio, we've got 4 weeks. Will the real Mitt Romney please stand up?
Well, you know,
I mean, this is a different response, or a response to a different point. When somebody says America is exceptional and American openness is essential, and you resort to something that probably sounds to younger people like an incredibly cynical perspective on the capacity of people to evaluate ideas, to discourse on, I don't like your haircut, I like his.
Yeah.
I don't have one.
Well, yeah. And, you know, and,
like
and
mine.
So if that's, if
it's,
that's,
it's the, it's
but
the,
if that's
look,
so.
As Churchill, no, as well, Churchill put it, it's the worst system except for all the others.
Well, but then that's you're talking about Thomas Hobbes or the Lord of the Flies. Then you're not talking about a kind of idealism.
Well,
you're talking about everything is bad.
But
wait a minute. Everything is not very good, and this is the least bad.
Correct.
Okay.
No, that's right.
So
I don't believe in human perfection. I don't believe that a dictator or a democracy can be perfect.
Right. But perfection wouldn't be the antithesis of the least bad. There surely must be something along the way a little better.
Well, that doesn't mean the least bad is horrible. I mean, there are plenty. If you have a lot of options on the table, maybe the least bad is just mediocre. But the bottom is, it's the least bad.
If you're a public relations man, you're probably not selling very many hamburgers if you tell anybody they're the least bad.
Of course you are. Your entire ad campaign is our hamburger is better than Burger King.
Better than. And it's not the least bad.
Well,
That's a different connotation.
Of course, every comparison is basically, I am better than X. That means I am the least bad choice between X and Y.
No, but we're talking about the difference between good dog food and bad dog food.
I don't eat dog food.
And glad to hear it.
You've lost me. But you're talking about hamburgers and McDonald's, I can go there. Now you're talking about puppy chow, you lost me.
I think what I'm saying in an idealistic sense is whether or not a discussion that works for selling hamburgers is a cynical perception of the capacity of people to learn, to discourse, and to make decisions.
Yeah.
And surely when you're sitting in the salubrious discourses at the ubiquitous Harvard Law School, you're not talking about public relations. That's the world of esoterica. So why is that peculiar only to a discourse in a law school? Shouldn't we be asking more of a political exchange in America than quick hits and quick
outs? Oh, okay. You didn't ask me about you asked me about reality, not about what should be. In an ideal world, everybody would be a considered voter.
Well, I'm assuming that reality isn't only defined
in terms of reality.
Well, the question also brings up branding vis-a-vis politics.
Right.
And any successful campaign, any successful candidate, two examples, President Clinton, President Reagan, certainly I'm 40 years old, they're the most successful politicians of my lifetime, were very well branded because they knew who they were, and the people who managed their campaigns also knew who they were. They knew what they represented to the people who liked them. They knew what they represented to the voters, and they were sold and packaged effectively. When you have a candidate, and we're speaking now after a debate, who is as left, right, this way, that way, gray in the middle, flip, flop, flop, flip as Mitt Romney, you can't, that's a tough candidate to brand. President Obama is not a tough candidate to brand.
Yeah, but look, isn't the conception of branding part of this discussion? What is a brand? It's an image.
Yes.
It's a phrase.
Yes.
It's a quick hit.
Yes.
See it, recognize it, like it,
hope and
buy
change.
It,
hope
or
and change.
Buy something else.
Hope and change. That,
and
that's
and the meaning of the discussion in America of an exchange of political ideas is the equivalent of branding?
Well, I think in modern American politics, sometimes yes. I mean, look at the 30-second commercials that are on your television
well,
for these candidates.
Is the question
that's branding.
Well, then
that's
prima
high
facie,
level marketing.
Then prima facie, that's so. I guess the question really had to do with can't we do a
okay,
little
it's a normative
better.
Question. Okay, okay. I read it as a descriptive, not a normative question.
Okay, let's try the one on the Roberts Court. You get the one on the Supreme Court? The Supreme Court of the United States, by a 5-4 vote in the Citizens United case, has said that money is effectively the equivalent of speech, meaning that any limits on campaign financing are ipso facto limits on speech, according to Citizens United. According to Citizens United, there should be no infringement on the role of financial contributions by organizations or individuals in support of the candidates or issues these individuals or organizations favor. Do you feel, you guys feel, that money and speech are equivalents, or are unlimited financial contributions likely to skew the political message in favor of large donors in an American election and thus contradict the one man, one vote premise?
I mean, I would say yes and yes. I do feel that money and speech are, well, not equivalent. They're both covered by the First Amendment, which is a different question. I don't think that money equals speech, but I do think that the power of free speech entitles you to the power to buy ad time, for example.
No, but
or
what
buy
I'm
a
asking
newspaper.
Is, are we entitled
the of Citizens
to
United
limit?
Is,
you know what I'm asking? Are you entitled to limit the amount of money you can give vis-a-vis what I can give? Because if you give 50 times as much, your voice is 50 times as loud.
No. No.
You're not.
No, you're not. And the reason is because once you get to that point, you also have to limit. I mean, are we going to limit how many words that you speak on politics? The problem is this. We care a differing amount about politics. We all have different measures of how we can involve ourselves in politics. Some people are smarter. Some people are not as smart. Some people are more involved. Some people are less involved. If you're going to make everybody strictly equal in terms of their political input, you're going to have to exercise an enormous amount of top-down control on the political process that I'm deeply uncomfortable with.
But I
does that mean it'll skew the process?
That.
Yes.
I understand that, and I understand some reservations, but it's a little like the discussion of people who want to limit the use of weapons. And somebody says, you either get a tank and an AK-47, or you get a pistol. And if you limit the AK-47 and the tank, ipso facto, you're limiting the pistol. I don't think that's true. I said a reasonable person could make a decision. So all I'm really saying is, given the amounts of money on both sides piling into this thing, which clearly influences the content of the discussion, could we, I mean, there was a campaign, and Obama said he would take it, he didn't take it, so it's not a Democrat or Republican idea, but should we organize the giving of money or the financing of campaigns, take the money out of it and allow the content, if the money were equal, then the content, presumably.
Well, I mean, let me put it this way. If we could create an ideal world where everybody had precisely the same amount of speech, then maybe. But you are ignoring the fact that people are biased, and you're ignoring the fact that there are media out there, and you're ignoring, I mean, there are a lot of factors here. And the problem is, once you get into this business of micromanaging free speech, you are very dangerous.
What you're saying is you either control everything or you control nothing, which is not my position. I think a lot of the things you said is true. You understand what I'm saying? I think there is a plausible argument for limiting some of this. And again, in terms of, I mean, somebody who is giving, an oil company is giving money in South Dakota, isn't giving it to clean up the beaches in Santa Barbara.
You think?
Probably not.
Right.
So I mean, it's okay. So, but so we understand that there is a motive behind. So should we adjudicate that, or should we let it go?
You asked. Yeah. The bottom half of the question asks if money and speech are equivalents. I'll answer that by saying it occurs to me that money amplifies speech. I think that's what money does for speech. I think money amplifies speech. I have a tough time in our free country, and I believe it is. I have a tough time telling people how much can be given or cutting off someone's freedom to contribute X amount of dollars or to limit their contribution, if it's their money, to a campaign. The problem is, however, now, is, again, I'm applying it to this debate that we saw tonight. I'm applying it to this campaign. This is a very important campaign. We have these super PAC ads that are being run now. And that is a critical issue when it comes to campaign funding, where candidates, of course, these super PACs are set up, and the candidate, Mitt Romney usually, but Obama does it as well, they'll say, they have no direct involvement in the super PAC. Both candidates say it. And Mitt Romney, you know, ran these super PAC ads during the Republican primary viciously against guys like Newt Gingrich and Rick Santorum, and they begged him.
And vice versa.
And vice versa. they begged him to speak out against them, to speak out against the message in the super PAC, to disclaim it. He wouldn't do it. So we do have an environment now where candidates can sort of, and you talk about an utter lack of leadership, they can just sort of kind of sit by and say, oh yeah, everybody in that group is my friend. I know every one of those guys in that super PAC.
So your solution is what?
I don't know if I have a solution. I don't know if I have a solution. I think that because a side of me says these super PACs roll out the red carpet for candidates for president to not be credible people, and that's a problem. But at the same time, who am I to tell some millionaires that they can't run commercials on TV?
Okay, hey, let me do a couple more and let you guys make a final address to your constituency here. This is the one about...
I may be speaking to myself.
Nietzsche said those were the best conversations. Let's do the one on American infrastructure. You know that line? Nobody tells me anything new.
It's a great line.
In the 1960s, American infrastructure led the world. Today, China spends roughly 9% of its gross national product on infrastructure. The United States spends about 2.4%. How would Republicans or Democrats build a 21st century economy on America's deteriorating mid-20th century infrastructure? Do you consider an upgrade in infrastructure, airports, bridges, highways, high-speed rail, power plants, fiber optics, and so on, essential to developing a competitive contemporary economy? If so, how should American infrastructure be rebuilt? Is the ongoing debate regarding the role of government versus private enterprise one or the other a constructive discussion, or is a combination of the two? For example, in the recently proposed Chicago Infrastructure Trust, a viable solution?
Well, I mean, I'm not going to speak to the Chicago Infrastructure Trust because I just don't know enough about it. Yeah. But, you know, when it comes to, you know, I don't think that looking at differentials of spending as far as infrastructure is the best way to determine either the health of an economy or even the health of the infrastructure long term. Bottom line is that you can spend a lot of money on your infrastructure, and if you don't have a free economy, it's not going to help you very much. Do we need to upgrade our infrastructure?
The point is, does it facilitate a free economy? Does it facilitate a 21st century
economy? It depends. I mean, the Soviet Union had
On the train and go to San Fran in an hour and a half, does that help doing business between L.A. and San Fran?
It depends if it outweighs the cost of doing it. Right? I mean, there's always...
Who picks up the tab for that, I guess is the question.
Well, I think that... I oppose the high-speed rail because I think it's idiotic. I think the number of people who are going to be taking the train from San Francisco to L.A.
But okay, but you like airports, you like fiber optic lines.
Right, no, I'm not against all infrastructure. I mean,
whose responsibility is that is really the question.
It depends on the infrastructure project. It's not all infrastructure projects are created equal. I mean, to treat them as though they're all created equal is
short-sighted. That's okay. But I think it's fair to say that the bridge system in America, the train system, I mean, you travel, you walk into L.A., you walk out of Terminal 3.
They need an upgrade.
Of Terminal 3 in Beijing.
I'm not arguing for zero.
Everybody says this. And you walk into LAX and the drywall's falling off the walls and the escalators don't work and you can't find a door. America.
If that's America and we're also by far the most powerful economy on Earth, that doesn't mean that, you know, there are plenty of places that have nicer infrastructure in certain areas. The high-speed rail in China is a great example. That doesn't mean their economy is better than ours.
China's state capitalism. I'm not saying China is the way to do it. What I'm saying is to make our economy conversant, operationally intelligent.
I'm not anti-spending on infrastructure.
Well, right, but the fact of the matter is there hasn't been very much of that. When bridges are falling down and you look at, go into any airport in America, leave JFK and fly to Hamburg. I mean, it doesn't matter where you're going. I mean, almost, go to Incheon. It looks like something designed in L.A., but they couldn't build it, and they built it in Seoul. I mean, when you travel, you can, and that facilitates business, and it facilitates commerce, and all of that. It's not gaudy.
Okay.
It's not superficial.
You know what facilitates business more than anything else is business. The niceness of the airport is not what facilitates business. The number of businesses located near the airport is what's going to facilitate business.
If you can put 750 people on a plane versus 250, and if the movement of people facilitates business, it's not niceness of the airport, it's whether the capacity of...
Well, airplanes are not publicly funded infrastructure. I mean,
airports are, and of course, airlines contribute to that also.
Right.
I don't think we're arguing with each other here.
I mean, I agree that infrastructure is important, and I'm not sure that anybody would disagree that infrastructure is important.
I think we're not doing it, Ben, is the point.
We're not, go ahead. We're not doing it.
Well, I wholeheartedly support infrastructure enhancements to our infrastructure for a couple of reasons.
Which ones? I mean, everyone keeps talking about this like it's a general matter. Why don't we discuss these things on a project-by-project basis
and then we can talk rationally
about what's good and what's bad spending?
Right. It doesn't mean we're going to green light everything, but we've gotten to a point in our debate, specifically in this presidential election, when the President of the United States talks about American infrastructure and actually says to people, yeah, it's a really good thing that we have roads and bridges. You didn't build that. America built those roads. America built those bridges. He's right.
It is not the roads and bridges that made business successful. There are plenty of other countries that have roads and bridges,
but
the businesses are completely unsuccessful.
Right. Steve Jobs is Steve Jobs because he was born in America.
Not because of the street he lived on.
Well, I'm sure there was a street there, though. Right? Was there a street? Did he drive on a street?
You're mixing up necessary and sufficient. Okay, no. It is necessary for there to be roads. It is not sufficient for there to be roads. The idea that the road is what creates the success is asinine. I mean, it's like saying oxygen creates success.
Well, sure, oxygen creates success. In the absence,
we'd all be dead. That doesn't mean oxygen is the factor most responsible for the creation of business success.
If he lives in Afghanistan and there's no road, he can't drive to Microsoft.
Okay, the biggest problem you have in Afghanistan is not the absence of roads.
No,
it would be mass roving bands of people murdering each
guys,
other.
Hang on. Should there be a concerted effort to remedy that lagging from fiber optics? I mean, the question of whether fiber optics is okay, but high-speed rail is not okay. But conceptually, and if we agree that it should be done, who should pick up the tab?
Well, it should be done for the reasons have been articulated, but it should be done for an even bigger reason that hasn't been mentioned, jobs. It creates jobs. Now, you can roll out of your chair, but I'm an FDR Democrat, And it wasn't a terrible idea to fund national infrastructure projects that put millions of Americans back to work.
Well, no, the
why am I all of a sudden a socialist or a communist when I say, yes, we should build bridges? We should build roads. What's wrong with that?
The goal of building bridges and building roads is not to create jobs. If you're going, the question again, it always comes back to, is the bridge or is the road worthwhile? If it is not, you can create a lot of jobs. You can hire people to dig ditches and then fill them back in again. That creates jobs. The question is whether it's a job that helps the economy or whether it's a job that doesn't help the economy.
I think there are two points, and you know the point. I mean, the primary issue is to
there's a difference between a work program and a make work program.
Yeah, but to increase the capacity of the country to do the things that the country needs to do in a contemporary
economy. In a smart way, yes.
If in the process of doing that, you happen to create a few jobs.
And you will every time.
Fine. So the operational
temporary
principle is let's have
temporary
fiber optic line.
A guy who doesn't
and
have a
by
job
the way,
would
if somebody,
a temporary
somebody,
job, then no
if somebody
job
makes some money placing a fiber optic line, that's not pejorative.
Correct.
That's a good idea.
I agree.
So I think we still are not, because what's missing in the discussion, we need to do this, I think. We need to do this, not because China, because you can go from Shanghai to Beijing in 2 hours, and we have to compete with that. That's a more complicated question in terms of what really is a fascist economy, in however you want to, but nevertheless, you know, they and this is interesting in terms of imagery. It's a little bit off the topic here, whatever the topic is, but the presentation of the image of America as having a unique capacity to do wonderful things, put people. I have a little boy. I was reading a Jules Verne story, From Earth to Moon. You should check it out. Written in the middle of the 19th.
Yeah.
Okay, and it was written in the middle of the 19th century.
Will you
century
read it to me?
And I will. I will.
No, I mean tonight, right after this. Can we just cuddle in the back and can you read to me?
I get you the shortened version. But what's appealing about it, and you would never recognize it today, you wouldn't recognize it, is Jules Verne talking from a European point of view. In awe of the capacity of Americans to wonder about things and to implement them, and whether that's part of a passing phase or whether it can return or not. So when somebody says, "Let's go to the moon," whether it produces jobs, whether it one-ups Moscow, whatever it does, but what comes with wonder and energy and confidence and all of that, you could argue is what really makes America exceptional when it is. We don't do that. And when somebody says, but they got a train that goes from Shanghai to Beijing in 2 hours and 20 minutes, and you don't have anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
So conceptually, when you're looking at models of government, ways of solving problems, and somebody is saying in India, or somebody is saying in Brazil, or somebody is saying in China, and people are looking around, they're not quoting Jules Verne anymore. I don't know whether they're quoting Deng Xiaoping, but they're not quoting Jules Verne. So,
well,
I don't think you can manufacture that quality, you know, by saying American exceptional.
Well, I don't think that. I think we have two very different concepts of what American exceptional, and this is what I'll finish with, really. I mean, this is. I really don't think this is. To me, this is not what American exceptionalism constitutes. It's not, you know, the whiz bang project that we all put together through exorbitant use of tax dollars. It's the ability of a family to make choices about how they live their lives in freedom and to have a job that allows them to support that family. I'm far less concerned with building a high-speed rail. I don't think that's what makes America great. The fact is, you can always build something really, really cool if you commandeer the entire resources of an economy, which is what, you know, FDR did in large part. It's what they're doing in China. It's what they've done throughout history. You can build really neat things that stand the test of time.
Right,
what makes
then,
a nation
surely,
great?
Surely you don't want to argue for the opposite, do you?
No, what I'm arguing for is
there's a
conflict.
If you're talking about FDR, so who would your model be? Herbert Hoover?
No, Calvin Coolidge. There's a fundamental conflict in America, and there always has been, between the individual and the collective. And there is a balance to be had there, but the question is, on which side of the balance are you going to stand? And that's the real question of this election cycle. President Obama stands more on the side of the collective, and Mitt Romney stands more on the side of the individual, at least when it comes to economic matters fundamentally. And so when you're talking about economic matters, free speech, and those particular rights, this is the difference between positive rights and negative rights. Positive rights can create great things. That is not what makes America exceptional. It is negative rights in the absence of government, a smaller government that allows for your freedoms, that makes America a great country. If government provides you everything, it's the same government that has the power to take everything away from you.
I'm not afraid.
You know, it's interesting to listen to you talk because it seems to me you conflate a kind of idealistic sense of what America's capacities, or the citizens in America have the capacity to do in freedom, and then you argue for something that you call reality, which seems to be a very skeptical sense of really the capacity of people to do things that aren't really very special
at
all.
No. That's it. No, I think people are individually capable of doing extraordinary things with their lives. I don't think any individual is capable of running an entire economy. I don't think that any individual has the collective knowledge that is created by a free economy, where each person has, you know, maybe we all in this
room.
Right.
But who's arguing for that?
What the centrally planned economies? I mean, this is what we're talking about. A centrally planned economy. A centrally planned economy.
Geithner and Summers are the advocates of a planned economy.
Of central planning. They are of soft central planning. Summers less than Geithner, but yes.
I guess I'll close up on the heels of what my friend Ben said. Maybe I'm just nuts, but somewhere along the line, I was convinced as a kid in America that government can be a force for good in people's lives. And it's okay. And the government's not a terrible thing. It's really not. It's not a terrible thing. It can do terrible things, and it can take things away from you, and it can oppress people. But the American government, I don't think it's a terrible thing. President Obama talked tonight about the government being used as a ladder of opportunity for people. Mitt Romney just doesn't want the ladder there. He doesn't want that ladder there.
He doesn't believe that that ladder is the right ladder.
He doesn't know what he thinks.
It's not true. You don't know what he thinks.
I don't know what he thinks, and that's a problem because the election's 4 weeks away.
It's not a problem because you weren't going to vote for him in the first place.
It's a problem that I don't know what he... I'll tell you what I do know he thinks. I know he thinks that 47% of people who live...
Okay.
47% of people who live in America think they're victims. He said that.
President Obama believes 99% of people in America are victims of the 1%.
Yeah, I think that's not going to help us too much.
I think it's an important point to be made. I think it is. I'd like to make it, if I may. Because it speaks to the vilification of government and anything associated with government. When Mitt Romney said to a room full of donors, when he didn't know he was being taped, that 47% of Americans have cast themselves as victims, he's talking about moms on Social Security, grandmothers on Medicare, he's talking about veterans collecting from the VA. He didn't apologize for that statement tonight. He didn't apologize to the 47% of Americans who get some sort of check, whether it be because they paid into it and they're just getting back what they were told they would get.
You know, interestingly enough, I think Obama, Obama never mentioned it.
He should have brought it up.
He never said a word about it.
I think Jim Lehrer forgot that he said it.
Which is also, I mean, it's least interesting since it's been on a billion ads.
It didn't even come up. And Mitt Romney didn't seize the moment to apologize.
He could have mentioned it. He didn't, which is at least interesting. Let me just ask you this and we wind it up. Who won?
Well, I mean, I'll agree with Nicholas Kristof, Andrew Sullivan, and Bill Maher, all of whom agree that Romney did a much better job than Obama tonight.
I mean, who won means who won, not who you wish would have won.
Look, I am not a fan of Nicholas Kristof, as you may have realized at this point. You know, I'm not the only one out there who's saying that Romney did a better job.
You were a Bill Maher fan.
I am a Bill Maher fan. So it's who won?
No, I mean, who
won? Empirically,
who won, not I wish.
I think that, I think Mitt Romney had a better night than I thought he would have. I think he had a better night than I thought he would have. I think that President Obama, if I were advising the president, I would caution him, and this is just politics, this is pure politics. I like the president, I think he's a good man. I think he's been a good president, not a great president, but a good one. You know, he gets this look about him that you can tell, it reminds me of George Bush. You get that kind of scowl. Start to criticize him, you know, I don't like that. you know, Obama has a little bit of that going on. I try to lose that for the second debate. I don't think it's presidential. And I think Mitt Romney did an okay job. But you know what I learned tonight? And this is what I'll take away. This is a man who will gouge, who will gouge the middle class to prop up Wall Street and give millionaires a tax cut to shut down Sesame Street.
Wait a minute, be honest, you learned that tonight, or you always thought that?
Exactly. I mean, to be fair.
No, he said it tonight about Big Bird. It's the same line from these reports. Well, we like teachers, we just don't like their union. I like Big Bird, I just don't like PBS. Well, that doesn't make sense.
Of course it does. Big Bird is a profitable enterprise. It is. I mean, the Henson family makes a ton of money off of it. Fiscally speaking, Sesame Street actually does not need government funding.
A candidate for president vilifies Big Bird. I'm going to mention it.
Oh my God, imagine if he mentioned Omo.
Let me throw out a sense of what I heard. It seemed to me that Romney prepared better.
Yeah, I think that's true.
And I was sitting next to a colleague, and every time Obama would come with the usual, because you usually know what he'll say this. Okay, he'll say 47% and you'll say 99%. Or he'll say 47% and he'll say, but I'm really for 100%. My sense was, not going question by question, that Romney had anticipated the discussion about, you know, all the Republicans said he was going to get hammered because of what he did in Massachusetts healthcare. I think it's fair to say it's not that he's vulnerable in some ways, but that he handled it well, that he said, okay, this is an idea, it was a state idea, every state can do it, so on and so on. It just, whether you agree with it or not, as a tactical matter, it was plausible to you, but maybe he wasn't plausible to you and maybe to some other people. I think he got over the hump of the sort of odd guy who walks with a pole, you know. You know what I mean?
I don't know what you mean. Guy. Tell me more about that.
I think he could stand on the stage.
Yeah, but is it too late? I mean, it might be
that. I don't know. But
polls going in, we're dead even, so it's now a horse race. I think it's fair to say.
I think he, without talking about who one would prefer, seems to me that he did about as good a job as he can do. And I also think Obama, who is, when he's wheeling and dealing, a funny guy and an endearing guy and a jocular guy, was a little bit stiff. And it seemed to me, maybe I'm wrong, I'd be interested to hear what people say, that he wasn't as well prepared for the thing.
That's what happens when you don't have a teleprompter.
He needs a teleprompter. Okay, anybody want to throw out one or two points, or have you had enough? And if you have, I want to thank Benjamin Shapiro and Brian Whitman for giving us all their time. And
it's actually fun for Brian, because normally on the show, Brian's the designated punching bag.
Yeah, it's two conservatives against one on the morning radio show, so it's actually nice to be here with some people who live in 2012.
It's great to have you guys.
Did I say that out loud? I thought it. See, I think it, and then sometimes it came out loud, you heard it. Right?
Anyway, great to have you guys,
and we
appreciated it, learned a lot. Hope to see you again.
Appreciate it.
Hope your candidates all win.
Both of them.